Rob, you've written an article on the emergence of digital currencies like Bitcoin and the developments in payment technologies which underpin them. Now, before coming on to discuss this further, could you talk us through an electronic payment with a traditional currency such as sterling, say?
Well, if we start by thinking about what money is, money in modern economies typically takes the form of banknotes and coins, and in the vast majority of cases, deposits held in bank accounts. These are digital records of money balances. Essentially, they only exist as data in a computer. Making payments is a matter of agreeing a system to make changes to these records securely. So let's take a very quick example. Imagine Anne wants to transfer money to Fred electronically. Let's assume they use different banks, in which case the payment goes from Anne's bank to Fred's via some central entity, typically a central bank, and the Bank of England sits at the centre of most payment systems in the UK.
Increasingly, people want to make payments online or on the move, and your article discusses some recent innovations which allows people to make payments in a more convenient way.
Yes, this includes services like PayM in the UK, which allows users to access existing payment systems using their mobile phones, and M-Pesa in Kenya, which also uses mobile phones, but the difference is that M-Pesa users don't need access to a bank account. These systems still rely on a trusted central entity, be it a bank or a mobile phone company. Most recently, digital currencies have emerged, which are structurally different to other innovations.
Your article explains what digital currencies like Bitcoin are and how they work.
That's right. And a key point to note is that a digital currency is both a payment system and a currency. This can get lost because a lot of the media attention focuses on swings in the price of the currency, but the real innovation is the decentralized payment system. To see this, if we go back to the example that Anne wants to transfer money to Fred, but this time she's transferring a digital currency like Bitcoin. This is paid direct from Anne to Fred. There are no banks involved. Without a central third party, there needs to be a secure way for everyone to agree changes to the ledger, since digital information is, in principle, easy to change and copy. Digital currencies overcome this by making it possible for a reliable copy of the ledger to be distributed to everybody in the system. This rethinking of payments is made possible by combining existing technologies like the internet, cryptography, and high-volume data storage. The article explained how this works in more detail.
So a key difference then is that whereas centralized systems rely on everyone to trust some third party to keep a digital record that's correct, a Bitcoin transaction relies on there being many copies of this digital record which are distributed to many users across the network.
That's right. And this means you don't have to rely on the trustworthiness of any single entity, just that the cryptography works.
You also discuss some possible applications of the distributed ledger technology beyond payments. What are some of these possibilities?
Like money, most financial assets are just digital records. So for example, if you own a share in a company, you don't have a physical certificate anymore. What you actually own is a record in a database managed by a trusted third party. We don't make any predictions about this in the article, but we make the point that given these records are already digital, it is at least conceivable that over time, the centralized infrastructures of the financial system could gradually be replaced by decentralized systems.
And so how does this affect the Bank of England?
Given its role in protecting monetary and financial stability in the UK, the bank monitors closely any developments in new technology, as well as any risks posed to its objectives.
Rob, thanks very much.
Thanks.